So we're going to have a little chat up here, and then we're going to show a piece of this series. So this is by no means the first program ever made about climate change, but it does seem that, you know, with the IPCC just coming out with a report that was had the language quite carefully calibrated around we're stacking up a bunch of risks we don't really know how to manage. Why did you choose to be involved in this particular enterprise and this particular series?
Well, Richard, first of all, thank you for having us here, and thank you all for coming out, and we hope you enjoy the show. I happen to be working on my own path, looking at how climate environmental issues underlay the Arab Spring. And I was approached, not one of the founders, and we must give due credit to the true creators of this project, which are David Gelbar and Joel Bach, who are two ex-60 Minutes producers who were frustrated by the fact that they couldn't get more climate stories on 60 Minutes. They quit their jobs, they went out and raised the money, they recruited the producers, but they are the true drivers of this. And I just want to be sure to give them a shout out. What is so exciting about this project for me is, first of all, the incredible quality of the people doing it in terms of just production values. And second, their aim, which is to tell the climate story through the lives of real people living it. And so Inconvenient Truth came along at a hugely important time when the issue was just dawning, but that was one man giving a lecture to millions, and very importantly, this is the millions giving a lecture to the world. And we really got to be the agents to really help them tell their story.
That's great. So billions telling their story to the world. As a scientist, it seems that we often stumble in terms of how you bring that science through the screen into the living room, into the group of people sitting around watching one television set. I mean, how as a scientist should we look at the future? I mean, what more is there more science that's needed? Is it the communication of the science that's needed? How do we bridge the science policy gap? I mean, how do you see the steps forward?
Well, first of all, thank you, Rachel and Tom, and to all of you. When I was in graduate school, I was an intern here at the World Bank, and if someone had told me back then that we would do something on climate change, and the president of the World Bank would be introducing it, it just would have been unimaginable. So in some ways, that progress has happened. And it's an amazingly positive thing to see that, for me to personally see that here. Look, I'm a scientist, but I'm not a climate scientist. And when I was first approached to do the show, I actually said no, because I'd done energy shows before, and I just didn't think we were going to be able to communicate it. Science, in some ways, especially this science, complicated, complex, with uncertainties, it's not going to make good television, is it? I mean, really, come on, was it? And so I didn't want to go spend, you know, a month or two doing this thing and not having people watch it. But I ended up going on Letterman. And David Letterman is really deeply passionate about this issue. And he grilled me on climate change. I mean, I had all these great stories about seeing polar bears and wrestling sharks and all this stuff. We never got to it. We just talked about this issue. And I walked out of there thinking, man, I'm telling a story that I don't feel in my bones. I'm regurgitating what I am reading as a scientist. I intellectually understand it, but I don't feel it in my bones. So when Joel Bach and David Gelber gave me the chance, they said, we will send you to the field. We will literally send you to the ends of the earth. They didn't tell me they'd also like try to kill me on the show, but they did say, we'll send you out there with the scientists that you want to go out with and come back and tell us, do you feel it in your bones? I felt that that's what needed to happen. The stuff that I do on screen, in the episodes that I'm in episode 3, for example, you'll see these scientists as real people. And I think revealing that they are real people, I know that sounds strange, right? But they're real people with families, with worries, with uncertainties, with challenges, makes them more believable. And to me, that's the message that we need to do. It's not doing better science. Obviously, we need better science. Obviously, there are some uncertainties we want to tighten up. But now the issue is about how the public views people who don't see as their peers. And if we can make these people their neighbors, then they're more likely to believe them.
So journalists are real people too, right?
Some of them.
I want to push you. I want to push you a little bit on the media here, because you talked about the inspiration from this film coming from two guys who quit their jobs at 60 Minutes. I'm British, and there's a roiling debate in the UK at the moment about the role that the BBC is playing in covering climate, and this moral equivalency of the one scientist who disagrees who gets equal airtime to the 1,399 who don't. And then your own paper, you know, put an op-ed about this film from two guys who've seen the trailer and a bit of episode one on YouTube. What's going on? Who's the media catering to?
Well, you know, I'm not going to criticize my own paper, but those two guys are knuckleheads. I mean, so actually, it's legitimate to critique the whole series if you've seen the whole series, but to critique it on the basis of a trailer, you know, and say the trailer was breathless. Have you ever seen a trailer that wasn't breathless?
It's Showtime. That's the whole
idea. You know, I can't speak for the media, and I don't. I actually was thinking about a column after I read that op-ed piece yesterday. And the column is these guys are just so worried that we're turning people off by exaggerating the story. Well, I don't think we exaggerate the story. We tell the story very carefully without exaggeration. I think people will see. But I've been thinking of doing a column that would sort of say, you're so mobilized against this. Let me try to think through, what is the disaster that you're preventing? Okay, what is the disaster? Because like, if we actually took climate change seriously, and there turned out you were right, there was no climate change, what is the disaster you would be preventing? Well, let's see, well, if we took it seriously, what we'd actually do in America is we'd get rid of both income taxes and corporate taxes and replace them with a carbon tax. In other words, we'd get people to actually, use their finances to stop something we don't want and to incentivize something we do want, which is investment and employment. That's the first disaster that we would cause. The second disaster is we would actually borrow billions of dollars today at almost zero interest in order to invest in infrastructure at a time when we have a $2 trillion infrastructure deficit, to improve our ports, airports, roads, harbors, and seaports, to make our country more resilient and, as a byproduct, more productive, and create jobs. That's disaster number two, that these guys are throwing their bodies in the way of preventing. Third disaster is we would direct much more money to ARPA-E and all the government investments in research and innovation in clean tech to ensure that in a world that is getting hot, flat, and crowded, that is, we're going from 7 billion to 9 billion, and now the UN has just told us 9.6 billion people between now and 2050. In a world that is flat, where they can see how everyone is living, aspire to how they live in American-sized homes, driving American-sized cars on American-sized roads, eating American-sized Big Macs, when flat meets crowded, you don't need to have any climate debate, okay? We're gonna burn up, choke up, heat up, and smoke up this planet faster than anyone can possibly imagine. So that says one thing that is indisputable. The next great global industry is gonna be clean power, clean water, clean tech, okay? The only question is, are we gonna participate in it or not? So the fact that we might actually invest more in the research that would ensure that our companies play a leading role in the next great global industry, that is the third disaster that they are preventing. The fourth disaster they're preventing is that we might actually, as a byproduct of all that, weaken petro-dictators who use oil revenue in order to keep their people down and take bites out of neighboring countries. So I'm so grateful for these guys who don't want us to exaggerate, because we might actually do those four disastrous things and be like someone who prepared for the Olympic triathlon and didn't make the Olympics, but ended up healthier and more fit and more able to thrive in today's world. So thank those guys. I'm so grateful for what they're preventing.
So when you talk to other scientists, to psychologists and behavioral cognitive neuroscientists and all the rest of it, you know, they'll tell you that, you know, a healthy dose of fear switches the emotional brain on, and then you've got to connect, right? It's got to be an emotional reaction. You talked about, you know, as a scientist, you know, feeling it in your bones. And then you talk about some of the work that they've done in road testing messaging around climate change. And they'll tell you that the two audiences which are the least resistant and the most problematic are environmentalists and engineers, because they just have to get the perfect message, right, rather than the emotional message that connects. So you're working in an environmental organization, right? Conservation International, fantastic organization. How do we change the way we communicate this so it's not just seen as an environmental external threat, but it's about how our children breathe, it's about where the next job's gonna come from. I mean, how do we make that transition, because a lot of the pioneering leadership is still coming out of the environment movement?
So for a long time, when I was in graduate school, I really thought that what I was going to do is go out and save nature. I really believed this. I wasn't allowed to say that because I'm Asian, and my parents, you know, for them it has to be doctors, engineers, or lawyers. You know, that was the path. But eventually I convinced them there was something here and I could actually make sort of a living on it. And, you know, so that was what I thought I would do. But what I really do is now deal with people's lives. Because when you do have a planet with 7 billion plus, then sustainability equals availability. Mm-hmm. If you want to sell to a global marketplace, doesn't matter what company you're in, doesn't matter what you're in, you are in the business of thinking about availability for resources, then you're in the business of thinking about sustainability, whether you're Coke or whether you're General Mills. And to me, that's been a big transformation that's happened now. And I'm pretty excited about that, because it gives you the chance to make our story about people's lives, their real lives, and the real problems they have to deal with, not just about the polar bear. Michael Mann had a great quote where he says, we are the polar bear right now. But I think that, you know, in terms of the messaging, the other piece of this, yes, you have to get the science right, and yes, you have to speak in terms that make sense to real people, but the messenger is also important. The messenger is also important. And I think that one of the challenges we've had with climate change, but other things as well, is that we have been, how should I say, maybe monochromatic in how we have thought about our messengers, who these people really are at the end of the day. There's a great book, there's a wonderful author by the name of Candace Millard, who's, after Tom, my second favorite author. But Candace wrote this book called Destiny of the Republic. It's a brilliant book, and it talks about President Garfield, and he gets shot. He doesn't last very long in office. He gets shot in Union Station. And he's lying there, and a surgeon comes up to him and says, don't touch him, don't touch him, don't touch the wound, because the surgeon had just studied in Europe under Lister's antiseptic methods. He knew that touching the wound meant, you know, inducing an infection. But then another surgeon came in and said, no, you know, I'm going to probe the wound. And he was a much more senior guy. He was actually the surgeon who attended to Lincoln, by the way. And so what he does is he puts his finger up to the knuckle in the wound, looking for the bullet. And 70 days later, Garfield's dead, not because of the bullet, but because of this massive infection that happened. Now, what's interesting about the story is that that first doctor who came and said, don't touch the guy, he was black. He's actually a black Union soldier, surgeon. And likely because of his age, young, and likely because of his race, he was completely ignored. 10 years later, America had changed. They had understood that there was this thing called microbes. You couldn't see them, but they were going to kill you if you didn't wash your hands. You'd had this amazing transformation happen. We're in the same place with climate right now. If we have messengers who can relate to the people of the planet, can relate to this room, people out there, we have a better chance of getting our message heard.
Thank you very much. One of the great honors of working, yes, exactly. So one of the most, if you work in the World Bank Group, it's an incredible privilege. And one of the great honors is that as an organization that is responsive or attempts to be as responsive as possible to its clients, our inspiration comes from them. So for the Minister of Finance from the Philippines, who's here, who has to find a way to invest in the resilience of his country because the storm paths have changed and the intensity of those storms has changed, to the farmers of Western Kenya who are experimenting with new ways of growing crops that are short cropping, which are heat resistant and drought resistant and disease resistant and can work in a very different climatic conditions. We're honored to be able to try to find the solutions to respond to them. So would you please join me in thanking two brave communicators of the risks that we're running, and we're going to get off the stage and we're going to show you a piece of this wonderful series. And then after the screening, please join us outside where we will have some libations and some little nibbles for you to eat. Thank you very much indeed.